All right, we're now going to call our meeting to order. This is the Hockington Athletic Field Subcommittee. And is anyone here for public comment? All right, so on the agenda, we had the approval of minutes for last meeting, but we're actually going to postpone that to our next meeting. We need to work the draft a little bit. So certainly any comments you can send to me, but you all have the draft at this point. We can take care of that. So for today, our new business is the feasibility study report by Warner Larson. We're excited to hear the presentation today, so I'm not going to take up too much of our time in the beginning here. So I'd like to introduce David Warner and Josh Malani, who are here from Warner Larson, to give us our presentation.
Great, thank you, Dave.
Thank you.
It's great to be here. And what we're presenting today is a working draft to solicit as much input from you as possible. And we'll take your comments under advisement and go back and make adjustments to this so that we deliver you a final feasibility study for the synthetic turf options at the high school complex. Can we maybe turn off these lights here? Is that something there? Maybe a couple of these, because that would help. Is that okay for the TV?
Doesn't help for TV.
I'll be happy to know. All right, so it's going to be a little washed out. But I apologize for that. Also, the aspect ratio, just keep in mind, this is formatted for a screen against HDTV, and I'm not technical enough to make that adjustment right now for you. I'm sorry. So it's a little bit scrunched in terms of the image. So this is obviously the middle school and the high school complex, and we're studying the possibility of synthetic turf inside of the field inside of the track, as well as the baseball and softball field area here, and then out here, fields 12 and 13, right? These are 12 and 13. So off of the loop road, this is the Hopkins Elementary School. And we just took these snapshots of aerial photographs, and a couple more on the next slide I'll show you, to understand the context within which all of the athletic fields in the town and how they're being used. So these are all the fields on the high school, middle school, and Hopkins School site. But also we wanted to let you know that we've talked to Jay from Parks and Rec, Rogers, the facilities director, who's here, about usage town-wide to help understand that perspective on what the synthetic turf at the high school site could offer in terms of different types of use, community use, beyond just the high school, but beyond just the school's needs. So Elmwood School has this small field here because there's some youth soccer use there. Fruit Street is the prime youth soccer facility in town, and we have specifics in terms of the number of children at the various ages that play on those fields, as well as some of the adult leagues. But the two synthetic turf fields there, as well as the natural grass, EMC Park, Little League Complex, and to be honest, I don't know that much about the fields behind Cornell's, but those are other fields that we're aware exist in town. And from the aerial photographs, you can see soccer goals are set up out there as well. But that would be helpful to know a little bit more about how those fit into the overall sports program.
Those are privately owned.
Okay, privately owned. Okay, good. So probably should take that off the slide. Great. So that's the overview of the existing information. Now, I'm going to start in with the field options for the three areas of the high school site. Those are the ones that our study is charged with evaluating. So this plan is for field three, if you were to just turf the area inside the existing track. Now that existing track was resurfaced a few years ago, but by the time you know you're installing synthetic turf, we're looking at also resurfacing that again, which is on about a five-year cycle. That should be done, but everything else around it would remain existing. The home bleachers, the visitor bleachers, which are not up to code, but if that's done, if this turf is not disturbing them, that's a separate issue that the town can do outside of the timeline for synthetic turf. The D zones would remain as is natural grass. And the other thing is we we've been carrying upgrades to the fencing perimeter as well. Once you invest in synthetic turf, you want to protect it. We have carried a new 4'9" chain link fence in our estimates, but that's another question. A lot of facilities will have 6'5" fencing around a ticketed venue at a sporting facility like this. So this is the potential layouts for youth soccer are shown up over here. Why don't I zoom in on this so you can see a little bit better. So you can fit, you can see the three U10 fields on the left running perpendicular, or potentially six U8 fields, or a combination of, you know, two U10s and two U8s, or really almost any other combination, the one U10 and four U8s. But then I'll come back over to the this detail here show you that basically this is your minimum size varsity soccer field is right out close to the edge of the track, so the track itself would be used for the run-ins and run-outs, corner kicks, the throw-ins. It's very tight, I guess is the way of putting it, but it would allow for your varsity soccer and football to be played there. We're calling for refurbishment of the existing football goals. We think they're in decent shape. And that's basically the scope that's in that option.
About the cross, does that fit on there?
Yes, it does. The both boys and girls lacrosse, but it's, girls lacrosse is recommended to be wider than this allows. I think it's 190, 195 will fit, but it's recommended to be wider, and so. That's for new construction, and this is a retrofit. I think that if you look at the next option, that is where it's going to be a more ideal situation.
Would the league allow for girls across the plate after?
There's MIAA standards that, and so they do have a recommended. There's variations of what you can and are able to minimum, and I believe that is what we have out there right now is the minimum. It's just. You know, if you look at all the other factors in there, you're looking at a runoff off the track, safety, you know, it's dips there. Right
so
now,
this would take that dip out.
That would take correct. The dip out, yeah. Right. But like for right now, as it is, yeah. It's still, we're still in a tight spot because we're not looking at it. It's not ideal, but you can.
If you're building it new, we would make it wider. And that's where this option, which we're calling 1A, right? 1B, okay, so we call it first 1A, this is 1B.
Excuse me, and
did I have to put this on this one? Yes. So I'll just zoom in on this to show you how this field is widened out to allow for the 210 soccer, 70 yards, which is full size, gross across. Well, girls lacrosse and soccer have variable widths to them, but this is the recommended size. We didn't go any wider than that when we studied widening the track. So let me just explain the scope on this, what it means. The visitor bleachers would have to be removed, and we're expanding this out. I think it's about 15 or 20 feet. Is it 20 feet is this. So you're really talking about complete reconstruction of that track. Which means pulverizing and blending the asphalt that's there, grading that all out, even in the area that you're not changing because you don't want hole joints. If you were going to, say, cut the track here and here, reconstruct that radius and that radius, which is necessary in order to align with the new straightaway, you have a hole joint here and a hole joint there. At that point, you've got to just replace the whole track because going to end up seeing that joint showing up in the surface and imperfections with the rubber surfacing over time. So that's why on this option we're talking about complete rehabilitation of the track from the asphalt paving on up. As opposed to the previous option, the estimate was just to put put the undue pressure with the rubber surfacing on it to extend the life of the existing system for another 5 years. That's a maintenance cycle about every 5 to 7 years on resurfacing that track. We are also, on both options, resurfacing the long triple jumps down here, as well as the D zone, the high jump that didn't get colored in here, but that would be, that rubber surface would also be resurfaced as part of this. So as far as the potential for soccer layouts on here, and I should note that we do have down this corner just a point of reference for the various age groups and field sizes for soccer. But that's a point of reference that you can put hand up to take a look at. Zooming in up on the layouts here, we just have the potential for using slightly larger soccers for the age groups that we're representing on it. So for instance, these fields are a little bit longer, 180, and on these can also be a little bit wider because we have overall more turf on there, correct? So I'm just going to continue on to the other two locations, but I'm willing to take questions along the way if there are.
Has there been thoughts to putting youth soccer on these fields? Is that what we've done?
Yes.
I know you have the size chart down there for this multi-games, but at that point, you've got the 377 fields there. If you did a 99, are you only fitting one? That's what I was wondering, do you get two lengthwise?
Yeah, well, widthwise, normally, like over at Fruit Street, we split each length, the 11 into 2 99.
Okay.
So you could have two fields going across.
So, Josh, why don't we just put another diagram up here showing that layout?
So on option 1A, we can or cannot play women's field.
You can.
You can. And you can play soccer. Play football, play Miss Cross. What can't you play?
Well, it's just not the ideal size.
That's nice. So what we can't play, nothing, we can play everything.
But you can't play
NCAA
sports.
What's not ideal? Ideal is not ideal is women's lacrosse, soccer, men's and women's soccer. And if we had a turf field, is this the main field then for men's and women's soccer and women's field?
I don't even know that yet.
Yeah, I don't think we know the answer to that question.
Yet.
We have to hear all the information to be able to
do it. You can't do exhibition games here like NCAA stuff, right?
On this,
on
this
both options.
On option 1B, you can.
You can do, that's NCAA.
Yes. Option 1A, it's undersized on width for soccer, you cross across. We recommend it's that. But what we also have to take into consideration, we have a matrix we're going to show you on how we're doing some comparative analysis between the three different sites. This one already has the existing seating, the existing sports lighting, so those are investments that you do not need to make on the other two locations. You already have here, so in terms of this being a game location, it has those advantages of the existing infrastructure. The accessible route coming down to here, also in place, and the support building and the large parking area adjacent to are all very good adjacencies for this location. The others don't.
David, both options on the larger fields, like soccer and girls lacrosse, would have to have the bench areas on the track, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So that would be more wear on the track also.
Yes.
Bench areas.
Potentially, I mean, you can put down Trax Armor, which is like a felt fabric that rolls out to protect the surface to prevent that extra wear. And that is recommended wherever there's any high use, like crossing, and the athletes are going from outside the track onto the field. It's a felt material that rolls out to re-roll and also to prevent the cleats from tearing the rubber. But the visitor bleachers would then be reconstructed over here, and but the sports lighting that you have now, on either side there, does not get impacted by this. Those can remain where they are.
So we have to, go ahead.
If you change the visitor's bleachers, is that going to require us to put bathrooms in
Yes. And that is the seating, the bathroom facilities are for exterior viewing areas, sporting areas that have seating capacity are dictated by the plumbing code that's based upon the seating capacity. And right now, we understand that your facility operates using portable toilets for bigger events, but you don't have permanent bathroom facilities. I think that once you touch and recreate seating, it is going to trigger that. The code requires many more toilet fixtures than typically are needed for this type of event, and so a variance is always sought by a municipal to a high school facility for a reduced number of permanent bathrooms. But typically, the variance that's granted is for no less than 50% required by code. And so that would need to be factored into, and I think once you've touched and recreated the bleacher system, the building inspector, who is the code enforcement officer for the code of the town, would have to weigh in looking at the whole facility as to how we address that.
Is that a plumbing in the building?
Water.
I think there's water, but there's not in it.
Or drainage.
Water.
Would we be required by the league or the code or having to have visitors bleachers? If we took those out, would we have to replace them?
The bigger question is, does this construction, even though you don't put bleachers or portable bleachers, does this construction now affect our existing bleachers, which will be bathrooms? So either way, you may be looking at bathrooms if they count our existing structure.
But I mean, I've been to games all over the league this year, and let's say half of them have bleachers on one side and nothing on the other side.
Yeah. So for
and
example,
about the size of ours.
Yeah, and I think it depends on, I guess, the capacity of the building and size of school. I don't know if that impacts, and this is a good question that I can ask at the different TBL committees meetings, because like, I know Oxford Medway has on one side size standpoint, which is smaller than ours, so I don't know how they're looking, how that's done. Have you had experience in both sides of that with, you know, having just one side of bleachers versus two?
And it's always a debate on projects that we work on.
Okay.
What a lot of it is how you run functions there,
mm-hmm.
and for instance, if you were to dedicate a certain number of seats within here to students, and then the home teams, families, and that
mm-hmm.
sort of thing, then oftentimes, and if you've got a highly competitive game, you want your away team separate, or you know, for obvious reasons. Then I think having the visitor bleachers is good from that standpoint. From a code standpoint, you have to keep in mind that the maximum distance walking from your seat to a bathroom is 300 feet. So that became an issue on one of the projects working on Billerica, where the bathroom facilities were under the home bleachers in the design, and the visitor bleachers on the far side were about 500 or 600 feet away from the home bleachers. So if this building down here or something expanded in that area is the accommodations for bathroom and toilet fixtures, then that would be within 300 feet of both sides. So I don't think that's an issue on this side.
Is it a matter of portable or permanent structure?
The code specifically requires permanent, but the variance that's granted takes into consideration how you run your events and the capacity over time. So for instance, if you only have 4 events per year that draw a capacity that needs a certain the largest number of toilet fixtures, and those can be accommodated with portables, that's considered in the variance.
And then bleacher systems, portable or permanent bleachers?
Oh, good question. The permanent bleachers are the ones that drive the plumbing code.
And accessibility, right?
Yes. Portable bleachers that essentially become permanent or never moved should be factored into that. But if there are no bleachers there where the design is being done, and those were being portable and used on other fields, and you pulled them in for a large event, I think that's one way to look at how the portable toilets also would be associated with the portable seats. You know what I mean? It's about making a logical argument in the variance application that will satisfy the intent of the code, which is to make sure that people who need to use the bathroom don't have to wait an exorbitant amount of time to do so. That's really the intent.
What's the impact of 1B on the fields next to it and the hill?
Oh, good question. I think that it's maybe a little hard to see here, so I don't know if we have enough detail here to zoom in on the show, but the, okay, so the contours, you see these lines here. These are the existing contours, right, that came through from the survey underneath, and you see how they run all the way through. You have a retaining wall now that would need to be extended. Well, actually, there's a retaining wall that sits in here more. This is a new retaining wall, and the toe of the slope where your other field begins, we're not even, this retaining wall is uphill of that. So there's no impact spatially to it. And this would have a fence on the top of it. This would be a level area for the visitor bleachers. And the lights, which we aren't showing, but are several feet off of this retaining wall, would be impacted.
So it's really just an additional cost driver.
Yes.
Dave, to go back to restrooms again, if we didn't do visitor bleachers, could we use the existing middle school building, open up the existing middle school building for the home stands? Because that's probably, that, did you say 350 feet?
300. If you have an accessible entrance to the building that's within 300 feet that is available, has an accessible route to it, and is available unrestricted to public access.
Accessible route. Yeah.
So there's the accessible route and also unrestricted public access. Like if they need to go to a supervisor or someone to get the key, you know, then it's all accessibility regulations are driven by whether or not it's free access. Otherwise, it would be considered discriminatory. If an able-bodied person is able to do something, but then someone in a wheelchair is it. That's also a factor. But 300 feet, unrestricted access and accessible route. I think the problem is here is if you have a field in between, and the way to get to here, the accessible route is by vehicle to a parking spot down there. So I think the bathroom facilities would need to be down within the
bathroom shuttle field area.
Bathroom shuttles.
Okay, so let's move on to fields 4 and 5, which is the large field area immediately below the track. So this area has a cross pitch, generally high on the side, pitching off in this direction. Some of the other contextual information here is that there is a flagged wetland along this lower edge, and you can see this blue outline here. That's a 100-foot offset, so that's jurisdictional to the under the Wetlands Protection Act, enforced by the Conservation Commission. So any work within this area would trigger a notice of intent permit process. The route to this field would be the existing continuation of that drive that comes all the way down to this point. So there would be the ability to provide access down there, similar to the access that's coming in at the track. It would need to be a paved parking area, turnaround, accessible parking area. But what we're showing here is the whole area being turfed, and I think that was about 159,000 square feet overall. And the main layout of that space would preserve the existing baseball field and softball field. What we're suggesting is that this whole thing be synthetic turf, because you really don't want to make a change from synthetic to natural, I think, in this area. Because that way it allows the maximum types of overlay fields possible. But there is the possibility of keeping the pitcher's mound, natural clay mound. I think that's really important for the sport, for practicing on it. The baseball pitchers, when they're practicing on a synthetic mound, it's a totally different experience. And I think this being your varsity field, you want to make sure that that has that ability, as well as potentially the same experience maybe at the batter's box or being played. And that, given that, you really can't take advantage of the synthetic turf in this area for other field overlays. So this is showing your main soccer field, varsity soccer, 210, by 330, right? We have overrun space. The potential for, you know, we're showing on the softball field a couple of U8s, U10, right? And a football practice. There is the possibility we're showing up here for a full football practice down here, but I think in either situation, even here, we want to make sure that the football goalpost is removable so that in spring season, you absolutely need to have it removable here, and I think here as well, because it's in foul territory. You've got to have that post removed. The potential for different layouts that we're showing here to the right are, it was talking about, you know, football practice, an overlay on top of the soccer, the U10, U8 down here, or this gets cut off in the street.
Put all the people.
Hand over all the way on my monitor. But, you know, quite a few different combinations of youth soccer. The main thing to keep in mind here is that there's a cross pitch going on. So these fields that are oriented this way are running uphill, downhill when you're playing the sport, versus inside the track, it's just a subtle crown. It's pretty much a level area. And in terms of regrading here, I think we would just maintain the grade out there, level it off a little bit by filling in the side and maybe cutting a little bit over there. Because with synthetic turf, you don't need as much pitch, surface pitch, as you require on natural grass.
How much room is in between all these fields and those designs?
We have 15 feet.
That was 20 and 15 between here.
15 between the sides and 20 whenever we have an end zone coming close to a side zone.
We go across, would that fit on?
Yeah, no problem at all. It's,
okay, yeah.
I mean, this is one of the larger options. But the problem is that it is in the spring, is that it's conflicting with your softball and baseball use.
Right.
So we are really just looking at fall sports here as far as what can fit. Soccer, of course, field hockey can easily fit on here too. That's one of the smaller rectangles.
I just didn't know where the retaining wall is, the runoff. That's all I was looking at. But you just move over a little bit into where you have the baseball.
So if we were to retain some of the fill, it would be over on the side. But okay. I think over here. Joshua, do you remember what the grade change was across here? So probably about 1.5 to 2%.
I took a quick schematic look at it. We can get a 0.5% pitch shift for holding this corner. I think this we have the lower left foot, which is fine. We just extend the toe of the slope. So not a huge. There's no retaining walls on this plan.
Okay.
So it's just kind of low. I don't know what the overall drop might be. A foot and a half, 1 foot deep, 0.75 feet.
So this is not taking 1B into consideration.
Right. Well, what we're showing you here is essentially a menu of options. So right now we're just focused on this field area. But when you look at these individually, you could also see whether it makes sense to do more than one and whether it would be phased over time. I think those are ways which you take this information and start to think about how to implement it. But this being much larger in its square footage has a much higher synthetic turf cost to it. You're not going to do this. You're not going to subdivide this into two fields. I don't think you really want to do just this or just that. If you're going to do this area, you do the whole thing in synthetic turf. Because the changes in the grade and the back of the fields are open and overlap with the field of fall sports.
Yeah, I guess what I'm getting at is the retaining wall.
The retaining wall.
Yeah.
Oh.
There's no conflict. The 1B retaining wall, these are your lights existing. The retaining wall kind of stops right at the lights. So there's no impact. You could do both. You could do 1B and 2.
Yeah, they're mutually exclusive. And in fact, you could do all three. The next one we haven't shown yet. But I think that cost is going to be a major factor here in determining priorities.
If you're cutting it further than half, it would be the top wall.
There a change on here, you know, surface change from the
Yes, it would be a tan.
Does memory have nine video lecture surfaces that are grass, right?
They have track, they have the track surface for the field, but then the grass.
The outfield, right?
There.
Baseball.
They have baseball.
So the issue with that interface between clay and synthetic is that it's a maintenance thing. When that new soil, essentially the fines from the infill mix, will migrate into the turf and needs to be cleaned. The infill needs to be replenished with clay. Yeah, I mean, I think that's recommended anyway to keep it getting wet. Basically having a park cover that's custom size to that. But it would be a permanent mound, so that's why we wouldn't have a field going over top of it. We don't recommend a portable mound. I think the fact that those are, you know, those typically the short pile more than after turf type of a product is a totally different tactile experience for a pitcher than we have to dig into the pitching pipe.
And certainly these are potential layouts, but as a committee and, you know, working together with design, it might not even end up that baseball, softball, or, you know, those might could be relocated to grass as well. So I think if it's just to think about, there's multiple possibilities to find a decision.
That's a good point. I mean, we were, our baseline was that the existing sports that are used in these areas would be maintained, but if that is a different variable, we can factor that in.
I think it's something that we're, I don't want to speak for everyone, but for me, I'm willing to look at, because I think, you know, depending on sports that turf is really sort of ideal or essential versus it's nice to play on turf for this, but what's, you know, what's the rest of the league doing comparatively, those kinds of things. Obviously, there are certainly pros to it with our weather in the spring, but just I think that it's just something I'm putting out there that it doesn't have to definitely be that either. Something that we could look at depending on, you know, how we're looking forward in the design phase and the rest of our fields and how we could allocate them to different sports.
Yeah, the drawings that we got from the consultant that had provided drainage improvements to these lower fields several years ago showed that you've installed under drain systems all the way up through and underneath these fields. Those drainage improvements are really geared just for natural grass. So when the topsoil is stripped off and removed, we're starting a new square one, a new subgrade with a base stone material and layering up with the synthetic turf.
Did you look at lights? Are lights on this option?
That is one program element. I think lights, bathrooms, that type of thing. We don't have proposed seating here, but if there was proposed seating, whether we factor that in. I think that's so. Lights is definitely something that we want. So I think we don't have that in our.
We don't. It's in the matrix. You have two existing poles that you could potentially hang lights on the other side, but you would need to add more poles.
Yeah, so it's very likely you'd have two poles here, at least two poles there, two there. So you'd be adding at least six, maybe seven, one over here.
That would be good to add in, so just because obviously for us, we want to maximize the usage of the location for high school, community, and outside, so.
Okay. So I'll go on to the next area.
The need for new seating and off that is the harshest potential work for baseball.
So we hadn't shown any improvements to your existing conditions out there and around the backstop or the team areas or inspector seating. We would like to know specifically, you know, what your needs are there and move back to that.
And from a code standpoint, what do you have to be under to not to trigger that in the seats?
That's a really good question.
Because obviously you don't want to add
Yeah,
it also depends on what you want to do. So I mean, if you're trying to gear this area towards potential events and, you know, a revenue source, you're gonna want to make it as, you know, so
accessible and user friendly.
Right.
So I guess, you know, both options. You know, that you want to get that, the cost versus there's the cutoff to trigger that.
hypothetically, if it's, you know, 500 seats, I'm just making that up, but would you, what would be capacity for varsity baseball be for spectators? You know, if there's any input on that, that would be, maybe it's 200.
I think, quite frankly, if we were, I mean, it wouldn't need to be a ton of seating for varsity baseball game, just because of the nature of the sport. I think a lot of people tend to stand and watch around ball, kind of unfenced a lot. But I would say, depending on where we put, hypothetically, if it was not a baseball or softball field, and you're looking at bringing in a lot of people for an event, you know, there's two separate sort of needs there. I don't know the exact answer to that question.
Yeah, I think that portable seating down here makes sense too. You probably set up, you know, portable seats over here for a soccer game.
Yeah. So I'd say that might make sense to probably work for both, depending on if this was a location that was recommended and sort of what we were looking to do with it, something that we could make portable. So I don't know the seating. I think we'd look into that for you.
The other thing you mentioned too, I might add, the existing roadway.
Yes.
Going down, and other than putting in maybe some parking spots, is that going to be sufficient enough for rail traffic?
I think there's about, you mean the actual traffic flow?
Right, because if you're now talking games down there, you're going to, two-way traffic can't work there.
Right.
So it's one in, one out. Or
it is one of the limitations of the site in terms of the overall circulation. Got about a 60, I think it's about a 50 or 60 space parking lot here right now, and this would be the primary parking and access to it. It's definitely a lot less parking up here. If there's a major event, it's not reasonable really to have people parking up here.
And would that include access from that 50 car parking lot? Because there's none right now.
Yes, we would definitely be including an accessible route over. There's a berm there right now. We'd have to be leveled out with the paved access. So we'll make sure we show that on the diagram, and as well as the lighting to be in the updated estimate. Any other questions on this one?
Can the parking structure be expanded on the road?
Conservation restriction on the inside of the loop. I think the whole thing is
I'm going from memory on this too, because I haven't looked at the survey recently, but when we were working on the earlier projects here, there is definitely a lot of wetland area here in Merle Pools. You also have the old railhead that goes to there. So let's go back to 12 and 13. So this is in the far corner, southwest corner of the overall school parcel, school property, and it is the existing baseball field and this overlapping soccer field in there. We have maintained the exact same footprint of what's there in terms of the extents and what's rendered in green, but similar to previous option, we were proposing recreating this to flatten it out. Because on natural grass fields, you definitely need to have, you know, about 1.5% pitch to remove the surface water. Everything is pitched in this direction. So this point down here is about 5 feet lower than this point over here as a natural grass field. So we are proposing, and you can again see the wetland delineation from back when this project was initially built, but it had to be flagged. It was the vernal pool at that time, specifically up here with its own buffer zone associated with that. And you can see the blue outline for the bordering vegetated wetland on both the north and west side. This one would trigger the notice of intent for the Conservation Commission as well. But we're, as far as regrading, saying let's hold this side the same, because any raising of the grade up there would fill out in the area that's already been disturbed and revegetated. By lowering the grade over here by a couple of feet, putting in a wall, gravity wall, we can reduce the cross pitch on there to down, similar to 5, but this is just about much flatter surface, which we recommend for synthetic turf. In terms of the overall field size, you can see how the, I can zoom in on that, this is the full size soccer and potentially football practice. Football, we understand, you know, with the removal of goals, it might not be something that you end up choosing to do, but the, it does overlap on the baseball field. And lacrosse will be coming out to about the same point as well in terms of the length. So you have the potential for that conflict or a very short field. Oh, you do have that.
Okay.
Right. So yeah, you do have that overlap with lacrosse. Very short left field. If this was used maybe for practice at the same time, that's a possibility. But these are the various layouts with field size. I can just zoom in there and show you what we identified as possible configurations. Both the U10 and U8 soccer combinations. You also have one of the, you can see the full size high school soccer here. It's basically U14 and above. And then your U10 overlapping and U8s. They're also avoiding the pitcher's mound. The same logic we used for 4 and 5. Or a combination of, you know, U10s. And if these, basically what this is showing, these two U10s pull down a little bit more so they fit another U8 in there as well. Any examples?
Is it fitting up across the cross?
Yes. Which fits within the same footprint of the recommended size of varsity soccer.
Can you explain a little bit why you had mentioned the wall? You recommended the wall?
Yes, it's a retaining wall that is because the reducing the slope across this field from the 1.5% to 0.5%.
Okay.
You would end up having to shave off a little bit of grade all the way across here, which would get thicker and thicker the layer that you remove.
Yep.
To the point that you get over here, which would be a 2-foot depth of removal.
Okay. So you're looking at a short.
Yes, there would be a 2-foot high wall here that's well outside of the overrun space.
Okay. Have you thought about, or is this something you could add in about just maybe some netting and that kind of thing, something you could lacrosse or like a lot of balls flying?
So we do have netting in the process, both end zone and side.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so here in the end zone and then 50 feet out to the side. So for corner kicks or cross.
Okay. Thank you.
That's currently an issue with baseball now, foul balls and
on the third
base
field.
Side, yeah.
And this one I did carry chain link fence.
First base
side. On the left side of the field, the weapon side, or any other ball goes to 4-foot chain link. Same with option 2. On the weapon side, there's any process and there's chain link fence.
One thing that's coming to mind right now is, I mean, it's easy to control vehicular access, you know, with a barrier gate that you have up here. But what about unauthorized motorcycles, ATVs, that sort of thing going around in the woods? I don't know how much of an issue you might have out here, but this is a huge investment in synthetic turf. I think having a continuous barrier around the perimeter, this is something we should make sure we have just on the low side and the wetlands. I think conservation would expect that, but also complete the perimeter.
Yeah, it's an issue right now in general, so it's a good point to bring up, is that right now we have people going, unauthorized people going up there, and now it's to have that fun of dealing with tire marks on the field, all that kind of stuff, so whether natural or synthetic, we want to protect.
And lighting, like we talked before, so I think the lighting here, from a regulatory standpoint, is going to be a hot button issue with conservation, because there's the whole, when you have a vernal pool, there's this spring migration of the amphibians. The whole nocturnal, it happens at night and bright light, and the conflict there.
Yeah.
So in terms of trying to prioritize these various locations and the feasibility, not just cost, but also, you know, will just be
appreciated.
I would have to understand that there are some hurdles. This one has a higher regulatory bill than the other two options. The one inside the track is something that can be done as a right without, it's outside of the conservation commission's jurisdiction, but the fields 4 and 5 is also within the buffer zone. But already an active, more active close to a big facility, and lighting that might not be as big of an issue as here. That's just my gut instinct. Yes, down Chamberlain, right, to the south. So, and this, I think my aerial photograph shows that. Just off, so that, yeah, you know, there are butters over here, but I think that this, there are also butters over here, right? Just outside the view. Okay, so the other things I have to present are the detailed costs, but I think that we can also distribute those from the human comment. We've already gotten specific items that we're going to update them on. But I can open those up, and the evaluation matrix, I would like to show you that. So if I do this full screen. And it's legible. Or HD is much better. So, fields, option 1A, maybe I'll just look at the bottom line here so you can compare all of these. We're looking at about 1.5, 1.6 million. And that includes, you can see the major categories here. I'll go back to the top and scroll through them. There's a mobilization site prep, there's earthwork, which, you know, stripping and removal of the topsoil. The work in this area once it's removed. The synthetic turf, and we have like examples of systems and infills. We can get into that detail if you'd like today. The athletic equipment for their netting and fencing, and drainage, utilities, water service. So I think the things we need to add here, lighting, oh no, sorry, the lighting's already existing. Whether we need to expand on the bathrooms at all, you know, and question we had was perimeter fencing, 6 foot high. You know, is that the standard that we should be carrying at this point for a ticketed venue?
Yeah, I think so. You could give that one.
There's 4 foot out there right now, and
yeah,
what we typically carry is a 6 foot high black bond for a chain link fence, which is a pretty standard municipal athletic facility.
So sorry, this is the track standard.
This is 1A, which is not exactly.
Okay, just sorry.
So it's moving right along into the 1B. The major issue, major big cost here is rebuilding the track that will require design. And of course, the synthetic turf area is a little bit larger as a result. And the track would be completely reconstructed. And we're at about 2.4 million total. But the 1.6 is the estimated construction. Sorry. What are we looking at? Jobs for difference between these two other systems.
Construction is contractor overhead. And
Okay. General conditions, contractor overhead. That's about 10 or 12%.
So is that
also
based on
4 foot fence? Yes, that's not going to be a big difference.
And this was also based on
the facility, right? Is that something that you could break down? I don't know if this is something you do in your work, but if you're looking at the facility, looking at that as that structure, maybe it's already there, so I think that location is something that's also to give you the concession in the facility. I mean, I know that we're working on something that's another project in some ways, but just to get an idea of if we were going to look at this option or we're going to need that to some degree anyways, doing it in a way that sort of captures everything that we need to do that's the right now logistical issue for us.
Sure. Are you seeing all three of these locations potentially being, is that a parity issue between the three options, or is that primarily at the track that you're envisioning? What we're trying to do here as much as possible is have these, and we can break that out separately through this option so that it doesn't confuse the comparison of the where we build our turf.
Sure, I would think primarily for this option, because when I'm looking just thinking logistically about the other options, depending on, you know, if there's a fence and location. I'm looking at more of a, if it was going to be a ticketed event or something like that, then we could set up tables and do that. But I'm looking at this, at the where we are with field three, if we're looking at this structure existing, for example, we already have concessions there and things like that, which we want to keep, and if we're looking to add facilities, our other issue there is, well, we have some storage there, but we also have no entrance. There's no real entrance to that field.
You were looking for like a single point of entrance.
Yeah, single point of entrance where there's a booth, and it's, for example, from the parking lot down, it's an easy flow, an access route, whereas right now, everyone's coming every which way across the fields to get into our events, and most of the kids are hopping the fence, and the 4-foot fence. Right now. So I'm just saying, if just to see what the price is, so that if this was an option that we proposed, that would be part of the presentation.
Yeah, we'll we can look at what the code requirement is for number of fixtures, assume certain variance level, and then use a cost per square foot for the building.
Yeah.
Well, the question also comes, it's also slightly easy when you can mention like Holliston or Medway, but they've also incorporated their concession stand in their bathrooms where their entrance is, which puts it, depending on the plumbing perspective, I don't know what that does, but might put it closer in proximity to where there's already existing plumbing. Like if you have an access point, it has to be built over this way.
Right.
The other question I would have is that you need to think about providing
yeah,
challenging now to get to the existing fields.
Yeah, I mean, it is handicap accessible,
right.
But it's kind of a long way. It's, you know, you have to go around, but.
Well, and also the accessible parking is directly adjacent to the track. So that's technically compliant. You have a lot of able-bodied people walking from the large parking lot.
Right,
but that driveway coming down is a little over 5%, so it's technically not a accessible route. So that's why you have to have accessible parking down at the but another point to consider, and I think it supports your what you just said, Pete, is if you build the synthetic turf on 15.5 or 12.13, what you're doing is essentially leaving the natural grass inside the track as your main field where grass is appropriate, be cared for properly. So that would still serve as your main game event, which has the large crowds, the seating, concessions. And that supports the idea of not building those facilities in addition to that at the other locations. You know what I mean? So you have your synthetic turf in the areas for your practice of high wear and large capacity needs, but then you keep your game field with natural grass. For that's one other scenario here in doing fields 4 and 5 or 12 and 13 that enables that to be where all your utilities are already at and just expand upon. Potentially defer that further down the road because you're not actually doing it. So that's another consideration. So just look at the fields 4 and 5, which you'll see a significant increase in the synthetic turf cost. And this is a based upon unit prices that we're dealing with all the time in the industry. So that number is dealing with the base drainage turf edging materials. We've broken out separately fencing and also stripping the topsoil off. But it's the whole that's that whole profile under the synthetic turf. It's the carpet itself, the infill, the pad, the base material, and drainage system associated with it. So we are looking at $2.9 million for the overall project cost. And these multipliers are the same percentages on both in terms of you can focus on the construction cost because soft costs will vary. That may be a point of comparison if you want to, but in terms of project budgeting, 2.9 is what we're projecting for that area.
Your utility costs or your field drainage is covered under the field as opposed to site utilities?
Yeah, so the site utilities would be the all the services as well as the drainage connections and outfall. So the drainage underneath the field is the stone layer and then like a flat drain system collection.
Yeah,
and from that, so from that point where it needs to go, that's what that
that's what the second point is.
Going from the field to the outfall to the stormwater mitigation. So then on fields 12 and 13, we are looking at a similar synthetic turf cost because the area was 160,000, fields 4, 5, 5, 6,000 square foot difference. It's about the same square footage. We have a retaining wall that needs to be built. The other option doesn't have. But then overall, this is just over, well, it's 3.2. That's the budget amount. So it has more regrading associated with it. Retaining wall, a little bit larger synthetic turf footprint. Both fields 4 and 5 and 12 and 13 will need lighting added to them. So those numbers will change as a result of that. And perimeter fencing on fields 12 and 13. We should think about fields 4 and 5 and the extent of perimeter fencing around there. I think that that's probably a little easier to enclose because you're dealing with just two sides touching natural areas, you know, or potential areas for unauthorized access. So that one, I think, we'll take a close look at and make sure the diagram, Venn diagram, shows the extent we're recommending, and we'll put that in the estimate. The last page that I wanted to share with you, and you may recognize this from the Educational Facilities Planning and Building Committee matrix, but I think the thought process that was used on the early elementary school in terms of helping people visualize the differences in a more objective evaluation criteria and matter is helpful. So we've used a method that identifies, go to the bottom so you can see the categories, but most advantageous is green, neutral is yellow, and least advantageous is more of this orange. I think what I'd like to do is just distribute this amongst whoever wants to offer an opinion in your committee on this. And have you weigh in, but some of the information is very objective. In terms of field sizes, if we look at 1A, you know, we have a limitation in terms of the overall width, so that was orange. Whereas the other options for high school soccer are not a problem. And so the other, and those are listing all the different sports relative to field sizes. And then the contextual supporting facilities in terms of, you know, nearby parking, you know, other, you already have existing lighting or not, you know, we can rank all these different supporting facilities in here as the pros and cons. So you're not just looking at the cost, but you're looking at this one page overview of the three different options. And, you know, some of the ones that are green advantageous are obvious, but there might be some subjectivity to some of these as well. Permitting, regulatory, you know, clearly when you're out and back, it's going to be most difficult to have the track and field. That's really not going to be an issue. And then cost. Cost is certainly a very important factor. We want to make sure we summarize that on the sheet. So we'd like to distribute this and enable your input on the criteria. We can expand upon the criteria. And then also the considerations in the right-hand column as far as how the, what the points are, or what the rating is intended to be considering. We also have your list of 10 questions that you had emailed to me. If there's any, if you'd like me to go through and just read those off and offer you some initial input. Some of it deals with alternative infills and cost benefit analysis. In fact, why don't I show you that spreadsheet that we have as an example from another project. I think that when you're trying to look at justifying the investment, okay, so this was, it says another town in Massachusetts. I made it more generic so we can use it for presentations where we might want to keep the original source anonymous. But this is a project we did in Lunenburg, and it's no problem to share that with you. We looked at the initial cost of synthetic turf field, and the cost of a natural grass field. This was from scratch. This is a new high school, middle school, high school project. You know, how much, and this, these costs were from the schedule of value from the construction manager. So those were real costs that they were facing, how much it was going to cost. And then if they were going to build a synthetic turf field, those the costs associated with that. So we looked at what the premium was, that minus that is here. The other, the main way in which you can evaluate this investment objectively is to see how, what's the payback, I guess, in terms of, you know, how many fields do you have available? If this is allowing you to play more sports in, on a field that enables you not having to build other fields to accommodate those same sports. So we look at it from a cost per play, cost per use. The other, but before we get down to that, we factored in the maintenance, because obviously, as well, you probably all know that synthetic turf requires less maintenance. 5 or 10 years ago, people were telling you that it didn't require any maintenance. That's not true. But it's limited grooming, cleaning, and upkeep. And repairs are covered under an 8-year warranty, so you don't really have to factor in those. If you do just a green field and then you have striping, you're restricted to spring fall sports. But you can also have those done permanently. It's tufted in lines, so markings. But so we have a synthetic turf field maintenance budget over an 8-year cycle, which is the warranty period. And after which, you know, like we always recommend that you plan for a budget and replacement at that time. So that resets the clock. But then you have the maintenance costs for natural grass. We took their actual maintenance costs and looked at those and said, wow, you know, it's no wonder your fields didn't look so good because they're not getting maintained as well as they should be. And we did this analysis and they actually came up with a recommendation. So now the town actually has the budget to go back and seek additional funding for the natural grass fields maintenance program and improve that maintenance. Because the facility person out there was having a difficult time getting funding to maintain their fields properly. But in any case, we looked at both the recommended and the actual cost associated with that. The number of days, months out of the year that you can plant natural grass versus synthetic turf versus natural grass, and the actual cost per use as you think about the number of plays possible, and then if you have lights or not. If you have lights on synthetic turf, you can get up to maybe 3 events or 3 games per day. And the bottom line, inevitably, of all these analyses that I've done, is that synthetic turf will pay for itself over the life of the product, oftentimes within a year 4 or 5. So I think it's an easy argument to make to people who might be skeptical about the significant upfront costs associated with it. But that only deals with one of them, it's financial. The other aspect to it, as you probably know, there's been a lot of in the news about concerns about the health of players playing these fields, and that alternative infills are really being evaluated as, you know, as options in a lot of communities. For instance, Lunenburg did choose to use an alternative infill. Then the car tire round of rubber that people are hearing a lot about. The EPA, the federal EPA, is under mandate reevaluating their position on that. They expect to come out with a new report at some point next few months. We don't know exactly when, but that was after some analysis that was done, I think, out in California. In any case, we don't know where that's all going to come out. All of the testing that we've seen is that there's no direct physical health issue associated with pump rubber, but I think it's, if people are right now really planning for installation of synthetic turf in the near future, until that report it comes out, it's prudent to be studying alternatives and considering them. So one of your questions that perhaps you collected from the group was, you know, about organic inputs. I don't know how, maybe you can stop me from getting into too much detail, but I have a bunch of samples up here in terms of inputs, pads, and turf and everything else. But this is a really nice summary in a nutshell of different types of infill. You have there's like acrylic coated sand, crumb rubber, car tire. You have EPDM, which is a virgin rubber that doesn't come from car tires. It's the same rubber that's used in mats that go into gym floors and port-in-place surfacing in children's playgrounds. The thermoplastic plastic elastomer, which is a polyethylene polymer type of product. Wellesley's done two fields with this. And then you have a cork and a coconut blend, which is the organic, or I like to say plant-based, because organic sounds like it's certified with the FDA and it's not. And cork itself. Cork is very light and floats. It has a nice cushion effect to it, but it's very light. That's one of the downsides to maybe in many areas where if you have any issue with water flowing across the surface of the field, which you shouldn't with synthetic turf, because it drains so quickly. So EPDM is what it was lacking that Lunenburg used, and that was I think about a $65,000 upcharge over the front rubber on the overall field price. So the unit prices we're using for the synthetic turf would allow for that level of an upgrade, but the TPE or the Envirofill, which is a fill coated sand, those are significantly, they could be about $150,000 per field. And that is not the only factor in the unit prices. Organic is somewhere in between, so that is a legitimate, should I say plant-based, I just corrected myself. And one of your questions is, do they freeze? Does the organic material freeze? Yes, it does hold on to moisture, and that's one of the advantages of it. It will help to keep the synthetic turf a little cooler during the playing season by maybe 10 degrees. Now, that's not a big difference when you're talking about a field surface that with the rubber is going to get up maybe 140, 145 degrees surface temperature. It's very hot. If you're down around 130, 135, that's not a huge benefit, but it is a benefit later in the fall. The heat develops on these fields mostly in the late spring, early summer when the sun is highest in the sky. So that's late May, early May, June. And I think the way in which most municipalities are dealing with that is about scheduling games to avoid the peak hours of the day, 10 to 2 or 10 to 3. That's the best way to deal with it.
But organic requires irrigation?
It doesn't require it, believe it or not. There are some people in the industry who say it's recommended.
It dries out, though, right?
It does. It needs to be, for instance, in the high humid climates like where we are, the water would only be maybe once a month at the most. So
if you were into a drought like we have this year, you'd have issues with it, right?
You would need to apply water. I think that the best way to deal with something like that would be to set up one of these automatic, you probably know, but the KIFCO water reel.
It's a system. Traveler system.
Yeah. Instead of putting in a permanent irrigation system, and I think that because of the seldom use, but if it's in an arid area like Arizona, yes, you want to be watering them more.
And you need a pad too, right?
We recommend a pad even under the rubber system. And we have a lot of information, a lot of literature about that. It comes down to maintenance and the little white lie that the industry has been telling for the past 10 years or so. They stopped bragging about zero maintenance, thankfully, because you have to groom these fields to redistribute the infill. And if you're not, at those high wear zones, you know, in front of the goal mouse, line of scrimmage, lacrosse crease, corner kicks, that crumb rubber is going to get too shallow. And if you have, your kids are going to be falling on that. And they're not going to have the protection that the infill is supposed to have. So a pad underneath any field is really recommended, but it's essential. Absolutely essential. These alternative infills of the plant-based ones and the Envirofill in particular will not pass the GMAX test without having. You can get a rubber infill and a thermoplastic elastomer to pass a GMAX test if the infill is the proper depth. The problem is it's not maintained at the proper depth. So that's the.
Being the organic materials being organic, do they break down?
Believe it or not, the coconut and cork are very, very durable forms of, it has a lot of carbon in it, so it doesn't break down very much. So it does obviously break down a little bit with rubber, so you should be replenishing, topping it off every couple of years. So that should be factored into the maintenance program. We typically recommend synthetic turf fields that a minimum level of maintenance be contracted with the manufacturer certified installer. If you do that, you know you have, it's essentially outsourced, you have a company that's going to come in and do that and maintain that infill at a certain depth of the life of the product. You do need to replenish infill on rubber because it tracks off, you know, but not nearly as much.
Does these numbers include the training for maintenance staff now to maintain these fields during the year?
As far as maintenance is concerned, we didn't indicate who was doing it. It was really just broken down in terms of grooming, you know, painting lines, D-Max testing, and some miscellaneous repairs. But those numbers might be lower if you have in-house staff do it. The concern is that in a lot of communities it just wouldn't necessarily get done. It doesn't look like it needs maintenance.
So basically, these fields, the maintenance people don't have to do anything to them until the installers come out and you pay them to do it? So there's nothing for them to do that they need to know?
It all comes down to whether the local staff in the town are doing the grooming and the restriping or you're outsourcing.
I'm talking about the other stuff. Let's say the fields are in, they're already striped, ready to go, and on Saturday, somebody, well, whatever Saturday, you see something wrong, are they going to fix it or are they going to call in a contractor? Is there any training that they need to do?
Yes.
In between the big maintenance?
Yeah, typically, the training is in terms of how you use it and how you protect it. And in the warranty, what's written into the warranty is that the service provider, the installer service provider, would have a 24-hour response time. So if you're concerned about any safety issues or something that might need a repair before a big game event, you should be looking at it a few days prior to that event so you can make that call and have it and fix it. When it comes to synthetic turf, we recommend sewn seams. So there's a lot of details that go into how these go together besides just obviously contract buying turf from a good, reputable company as well as a certified installer from that reputable company. There's a lot of people undercut in this market and will sell a cheaper product with teams of installers that are cobbled together from people that are traveling the country doing this. It's really important to find a good source for a product with their certified installer so that you know you're going to get the workmanship on the installation that you need. Sewn seams is one of those. That glued seams is an issue where there's more of a point of failure because they actually have to cut through the backing, putting through. Those are the things that you go apart more. Or hard works from towns where they've been dealing with repairs, tripping hazards in the fields. Those are preventable. Good products installed
right. No, I get that. I just so this number you always do it, so I'm talking about that, which is still so.
It's probably expensive, but
I'm glad. Yes, so that I think was one of your questions, and it definitely could be plowed, different type of blade, plastic edge, held off the ground with these little skid discs that have to ride on the surface so that it doesn't scratch or dig into it. It leaves a little layer, but that layer melts very quickly because the sun goes through a thin layer of snow and it warms up the turf, so that's where the solar radiation effect on turf works to your advantage because it melts off there much faster than natural
gas. Is that usually outsourced or do people buy machines? You have that?
That's a good question. I know that there are installers in this area that have the capabilities to remove them. There are also third-party maintenance contractors who can do that.
Yep.
But you really have to check their qualifications.
Okay.
You don't want to just hire a guy with a pickup truck.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
No. Really,
he's going to figure out
what they do.
Okay.
So the main stadium field today has got that crown.
Yes.
You know, 1.5% from the center floor. So we looked at, and I saw that estimate there, $337K to just do grass field construction. We looked at just regrading that field, using it track to track, getting rid of that nasty soil on either side, doing some drainage.
We could
to stay with grass.
Our study is focused on synthetic turf. I think that a step back from that in order to accomplish the surface grading you're talking about would be more of a high performance root zone for natural grass, which is a high sand content, not a sand-based root zone, but some a root zone that has 80-85% sand content in it, and that will drain more freely. It resists wear and tear, but requires an even higher level of maintenance than just a native topsoil field in terms of irrigation and nutrient application. Thatch removal is increased as a result of the growth rate on the plant. Yeah, I mean, a natural grass, if that becomes, the synthetic turf is done in 4 to 5, and you want to improve that field to a better natural grass for your game field, I mean, that would be take. You would have a crown in that field, which would, with a higher sand content, you could keep the crown of the field at pitch about 1% gradient. With a native topsoil, you really got to have about 1.5 to 2. That field is probably closer to 2%. It really feels like a rounded ridge, and then the old,
about 10.
Yeah, feels like 10.
The older range system of the catch bases along here make the sidelines unusable now. So if you had that sand base for a high sand root zone, you come out and have trench drains at the edge to make sure that any surface water coming off the track, which right now flows onto the grass, goes into those catch bases at the place to go as well. We could put a price together for that and have that as an option. One C. But
I'm not a voting member, so I can't comment on these.
Yeah, but any questions, like in our planning phase, just looking at it, questions that we might get.
Yeah,
I think
they
could be
that. Definitely going to get
that. Yep. Yeah.
That would include it on the irrigation system.
Yeah.
So, can you ask, in the timeline perspective, how long the project would take?
The soft cost at the bottom in terms of testing, like survey, testing soil evaluation, engineering and design, those are, that's an excellent line. So, time frame for construction. The inside of the track is, without changing the outside of the track, is a very relatively quick project, I should say. We've done a couple of these in the past year, Southeast Regional Blue Hills, where, let's see, one was Green Acres, and one was Give Court contractor. And they were able to do that over the course of the summer. You know, some of the punch list and final finishing up is, you know, finished up in September. But that's the one thing to consider in terms of timing is that there's some weather-related factors here. Resurfacing the track has to be done when it's nice and warm and dry, over 60 degrees, temperatures rising. The track resurfacing is done after the turf goes in. That's the last thing to do. If that runs into the fall, you may end up pushing that resurfacing into the spring. That's what happens to the
surface.
And that's just the nature of the school calendar, trying to get the work done with the least amount of impact to, so that the field is available for the school's use in the spring. So that is feasible. When you renovate the track, do the grading and the retaining wall and the visitor bleachers out there, I would add another 8 weeks to that. So that's probably something that maybe you plan that year. There's no spring traffic at the center. I don't know if that's possible, but and they could start doing that work while maybe the natural grass field is being used inside and then finish the turf. There's ways to save that. We definitely would want to bid the work and have the contract on board well in advance of the end of the school year in the spring on any of these options so that they can get all their submittals in, contract paperwork is all set, and materials ordered so that when, because the process of removing the topsoil, putting in drainage, and creating the base is only a matter of a few weeks. And we don't want them sitting waiting for the turf to show up, so we want the turf to be arriving at the site when they're, or before they're ready to put it down, so that that doesn't delay the project at all. Fields 4, 5, and 12, and 13 don't have the track related implications associated with it. So that, I think, you know, again, in terms of the term is used in the industry, you probably heard of the summer slammer, but trying to fit you know, a project like this in that summer period, I think 8 to 12 weeks is reasonable to have a large area of turf put down like that without a whole lot of other limitations associated with it. Maybe some of the fencing continues into the fall as they're finishing up, that sort of thing. But I think that's reasonable to think about all of these projects as being done limited impact to the school's use of the facility, but allowing the contractors some latitude to start early on things that aren't going to impact or run late on things that impact the school's use. So yes, you asked about the overall time frame, and then whether they would be bundled together, design services and construction. I've never seen that done. Weston has just done something on their Parker Field, which is very unusual, where they put an RFP out there for design professionals to fully engineer and permit the project, get an estimate, go out to bid, and get a bid from a contractor before going to town meeting. That's very unusual. They were looking, I guess there was a previous project that was done in that town where the estimate numbers weren't sufficient to build the project, and they had to go back for additional money, and that was a big delay issue. So they said this time around we're going with a hard number, but they had to shell out all of the engineering permitting up front before they knew they had coming up with the building. I guess it's enough political support in the town for the project. That risk didn't seem to be significant to deter them from that. But typically, you do a study like this at some level of detail. Sometimes there are more complex options and some are less. But then you get an estimate that has enough contingency in it to deal with the unknowns. So that it's always fine if you don't use all of the money, right? You can return that back to the town. But it's always terrible if you don't have to do the project that you set out to do. Seek funding for full design engineering services after you have that estimate. Be able to go and bid and build that project. That's the second step. So I know your question must be thinking about when can this field be built ultimately.
Right, because it's just feeling like, this is going to be really a 2-year
playground. So the inside of the track is the low hanging fruit and it's the most streamlined in terms of schedule and cost. That's basically what Bloomberg did. They had an existing synthetic turf field that was being replaced. The example that I showed you was for Newfield, but they separately had an existing field just like this, except it was already synthetic and reached the end of its life expectancy. There is an option that they exercised that allowed them to save several weeks in their schedule. They already had the funding approved to build it, but they wanted the field done. They called me if it was in end of July. They said, we want this for our fall games this year. You're crazy, but there is this one possibility. You can buy the turf product through a national joint purchasing line. It's a lot like DPWs who buy trucks and equipment, or maybe school departments actually buy supplies. Right? Yeah, so the turf as a product, there's several companies out there that will sell the product through a purchasing line, and it's already been negotiated as a competitive price. And Lunenburg did that and hired us to bid out the labor and equipment for the demolition and the overall scope of the work associated with the turf to install it. And the criteria was that the installer was to be a manufacturer certified installer. They bought the turf from Shaw, which is a huge carpet company, very good reputation, backed by a big financial backing. And so you know they're going to be around for a while. And we had recommended that company or two others. He went to Shaw, and so the manufacturer certified installer local to the area, very good company. Was another way of ensuring that they got not just the right product, but also a good installer who was provide good workmanship. And that field is done, and they're planning it. They were able to have it available for their first home game, and we're very excited about that. So there are. That is one tool when you get closer to implementation that you decide whether to exercise or not. I think it has some real advantages in terms of your ability to control the source, the product, and the installer. And you do put an open bid out there, we have qualification requirements that meet Chapter 30B bidding laws in Massachusetts that do help to narrow it down, but you still need to consider three different alternatives. And we will walk you through that. You know, if you engage our services for the full design of this, we'll show you the three different companies. I can talk to you about that now if you're curious. But there's a whole process of bringing in the vendor, showing you all the products they have to offer, and helping you choose which ones are right to support. So, sorry, I talked a lot about your second question about combining. Do you have a third question?
Just with the design money, is already factored into the estimates?
It is, yeah. And in terms of the design process for this and that schedule, really, I think that we can put the design schedule in throughout 8 to 12 weeks, assuming a certain number of meetings and all of that. But I think that the big variable is the permitting time. We've permitted a number of projects in Hobbiton, and I think the ones that are a little bit more sensitive in nature with conservation take a little bit longer. I think my suggestion is, and I haven't operated outside of our communication loop here, but I think that if 12 to 13 is looking like it's a real possibility you want to consider seriously, we should talk to the conservation agent and about the implications and potential for having that approved by the Conservation Commission. And get more of an opinion from them than just we think it's the most difficult one that you need. If they say, if you have other options, like they might, I'm not putting words in their mouth, but they might say, if you have another place that you can do the same thing, and it's no either here or there in terms of design, they might say, we'd rather you stay away from that, or, you know, I don't know. But it would be good to get their input on that before we consider it a definite option to present to the public.
So if you are talking, going to that extent on 12 and 13, where the baseball field is currently, you know, is there room to expand that to do another full-size field perpendicular to the other rectangular field and expand parking?
Expanding this to accommodate another one of these fields on here?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I think the way to do that would be to add more length over here. But there's about, about 25 or 30 feet.
There's a pretty good cliff there.
Yeah, and it has a level spreader that collects the water that's discharging from underneath. And then there's a basin at the bottom. Those are fairly large earthworms that are dealing with the stormwater mitigation for the existing site. And those need to be altered to accommodate those changes and all of the field changes. I say that that's a point of diminishing returns because you're going in the direction of wetland resources. And if you remember, when you built the bridge here, and there's a lot of hydrologic flow that goes along through here. But I think it's an intermittent stream, if I remember correctly. But those are considered in migratory corridors, amphibian corridors, and we can talk specifics with the conservation agent that we've done. Yeah, would probably be willing to chat with us about this. I don't want to go public with any of this until your committee has directed us to do so, and probably have a representative attending with us before we do that, because I really don't want anything blowing up in the face of what you envision for an outcome here. I think that that's just the point of diminishing returns there, that you're not going to see the value of the additional space, whether
do you have any other questions? Did you feel, I feel like you covered a lot of what we've asked, is there anything on there?
Yeah, so
what's in front of me? Some of it you covered in your presentation.
Construction timeline, we talked about that. Parking and facilities, lighting, bathroom, ADA access, we talked about that. The specific usage for the fields and multi-purpose usage, I think that's about the different types of sports. What that's really going to come down to is the type of turf that you choose. I think that there's a more of a multi-purpose turf that has different types of turf in it. It's a shorter pile height that you probably end up with if you're going to be playing field hockey and soccer on it. And if it overlaps a baseball outfield,
mm-hmm.
Baseball field hockey are the two sports that really go for the shorter aisle, and you don't want to go so short that it makes soccer undesirable. The different types of infill, the maintenance plan, you haven't talked about that. The grading.
Yes.
Where does the dirt go? I don't have an answer for that. Usually,
I think we have a
first time with a bylaw in town. So that would probably trigger review of planning board. And, you know, if the school department has a place where, or if another town department, maybe Public Works, has a place where there's a need for topsoil. Say schools is giving it to parks or it's going to the cemetery, something like that, and it's being used in town, there's a way around that. But if it's being given to the contractor, it's being hauled out of town with a natural resource. That's what the zoning earth removal is focused on, and intending to preserve the second natural resources in town. But weather conditions affect readiness preparation. Synthetic turf is clearly able to be used in almost any weather condition. Doesn't freeze, was one of the questions. Yes, organic with the moisture content will, but it's kind of like a little bit of a crusty type of freeze, early in the morning type of thing. The sun gets on it, it softens right up. It's not something that is going to significantly change the impact attenuation and the safety factor on it, but it's going to feel different. But you're going to have the same type of thing. The fact that you can play longer into the fall or into the early winter on synthetic turf, on a natural grass field with a frozen solid, and you're comparing something that's a little bit crusty to something that's hard as a rock, and trying to talk about safety, it's really apples and oranges. Synthetic is certainly better in that situation. It doesn't seem that unsafe, so keep with the organic.
Thank you.
Does
anyone else have any other questions that weren't addressed?
So what we're going to do is we're going to package this all up with the updates, so it'll be in a single PDF document, and we can send that off to you. I'm happy to go back out and make another presentation. You know, if you'd like to go through that level of detail again, or if you want to individually review it, collect comments, and we'd be happy to make another revision after that before you go public with it. I know that we're also prepared to assist in sharing this information publicly.
Great, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay.
Oh, sure.
All right. Thank you, David and Josh, for your presentation. Moving on to old business, the only piece right now to just mention is that we had originally scheduled a public forum for November 7th. Given the timelines that it presented to us and looking ahead, it seems that November 7th might be we'll push that back right now, and we'll issue a press release on that. And at our next meeting, which is November 16th at 7 p.m., we'll be able to talk about a future date for that. Okay. So at this time, if there are any other questions or comments, all in favor? All right. Our meeting is adjourned. Thank you.